Can we start now? Okay. So I hope everyone has woken up properly and at least you can sit with a cup of coffee. How many of you attended the orientation session of IR which we had way back in June? Yeah, Yashwant, you were there. Okay, so what we will do today is we will do a micro analysis of the syllabus of international relations that has been given to us. And I'll give you a brief of briefly, we will start the evolution of Indian foreign policy, but mostly we will cover it tomorrow and day after. So today is just a general introduction of how we will approach this whole topic and the subject of international relations. Okay. One thing, have you covered world history and post-independence India already? Guys, have you covered your world history already? Okay. That's good then, because if you have covered your world history, then a lot of IR is much easier to understand. Okay, post-independence is fine, but if you have covered world history, then it's good enough. So, see, the first thing that we need to understand when we start with international relations is there is a lot of background noise at someone's end. If you can unmute your someone who's okay. So generally, what I've seen is that students fall in two categories when it comes to this subject. One are those who develop an interest in the subject and try to go much beyond the syllabus and kind of move towards, developing a very scholarly understanding of the subject. Like you will read each and every editorial that will come in the newspaper, make notes on it, go to the websites of think tanks and read things from there. So one is that category of students who go the extra mile. And another, what happens is many students, what they do is you start referring to the monthly current affair magazines, where every month at least around 15 to a maximum of 20 pages are devoted to IR. Now, if you read those monthly current affairs magazines, what happens is by the end of the year, when you have to sit for the exam, that 20 multiplied by 12 becomes nearly 200 pages worth of compilation, which is also not good enough for you to answer questions in the exam. So this becomes a problem, because what happens is the syllabus does not give you a lot of information as to how to approach the subject. It is very indicative in nature, in the sense that some broad topics are given, like developments in developed and developing countries and how it impacts India, or diaspora. So this way we have a broad listing of 4-5 topics. So what we will generally do when we are studying IR is we take a region-based approach. Now, what do I mean by taking a region-based approach? For instance, we start first with, say, your West Asia, with South Asia, okay? Because the first thing that our syllabus tells us is about India's relationship with neighboring countries. So we start with South Asia, then we go to other regions like West Asia. These days, Central Asia is becoming very important. Then your Africa. And when it comes to the major powers like China, we will do separately. US, we will do separately. Russia, we will do separately. And one thing that is emerging these days as very important in the study of IR is the maritime domain. So there you have your Indo-Pacific. So this is, and there will be some more divisions like your international organizations. But generally, when it comes to covering India's relations vis-a-vis other countries, then obviously it is not possible to for us to study about India's bilateral relation with each and every country of the world. So we take this region-based approach, and within that, we select some countries with which we study the bilateral relations. So to start with, suppose we are taking up South Asia, because that is what we are going to cover first. We'll cover India's relationship with South Asia first. When it comes to South Asia, one question that I want to ask you is, in South Asia, and this just from your overall reading and your general knowledge, just tell me, in South Asia, when it comes to India's relations, are these relations conducted in a bilateral form or a multilateral form? Can you tell me, in India's relations with South Asia, which format is used? Bilateral format, that is India with Nepal, India with Bhutan, India with Bangladesh, that's bilateral. And multilateral will be if we are taking the help of some regional organization, say SAARC or BIMSTEC. These are the regional organization. Which mode is preferred in South Asia? Multilateral, okay, sir. Ravi and Harsha are saying multilateral, which is actually not correct, because if you see an organization like SAARC, which you can say is a regional organization, is almost defunct, mainly because of India Pakistan not getting along with each other. SAARC summits have so many times been postponed. It was revived a little bit during COVID, but generally, since we had the, because of terrorism and India-Pakistan tension, SAARC summits get postponed. BIMSTEC is not particularly, say, a South Asian regional organization. It also includes a little bit of Southeast Asia. So you will see that when it comes to India's relations with South Asia, the bilateral format is actually more important. That is, we have to see our relationship with all of our neighboring countries, all the South Asian countries, separately. Because regionalism itself in South Asia is very weak. And we will come to this as to why this is weak when I start telling you about more about South Asia. Regionalism in South Asia is very weak. Do we have an organization like EU in South Asia? We don't, right? So that much of integration has not happened only in South Asia. That is why relationships tend to be at the bilateral level. So you will see, we have to study India-Bangladesh separately. We have to study India-Bhutan separately. India-Nepal separately. So when it comes to South Asia, we'll have to prepare all of this separately. There is, I mean, it depends, like with respect to some countries, we have to prepare a little more. When it comes to Nepal, Bhutan, we can prepare a little less. So, but we have to do all of that in the bilateral format, separately with each country. Now, another thing that becomes important when it concerns South Asia, the reason being that questions are asked from there and it is in our neighborhood, is any internal development that happens in our neighboring countries, questions are asked from there as well. So for example, in 2016 and 15, both years, questions were asked with relation to some internal developments of Bangladesh. Like there were some protests happening in Bangladesh at that time. And questions were asked as to how those protests impact India or India's relationship, the relationship between Bangladesh and India. If you have been following the newspaper for the last 1.5 to 1 year, you would know that there is a lot of political turmoil that is happening in Nepal. Okay, and how it impacted India's relationship is, did you come across this news where this region of Kalapani was included, Nepal changed its map to include the region of Kalapani in its map, and because India had made some changes in its map. So this was actually an impact of Nepal's internal politics as well. Okay, like, you know that Nepal had a long history of civil war, and when the Maoists came to power. So one of the things with Nepal is that Nepal, there is a lot of controversy that goes on in Nepal with respect to the formation of their constitution. And this is a big challenge in South Asia that is related to constitution. You will see the challenge of constitution making and how it impacts these countries in Nepal. You will see the constitution making as a problem in Sri Lanka. And this, because these are our neighboring countries, internal developments in our neighboring countries has an impact on India. So again, when it comes to South Asia, we have to see first, we have to prepare through a bilateral lens. That is, we have to prepare India's relationship with each and every country individually. Second, we have to look at the internal developments in some of these countries, how it impacts India. Now why am I emphasizing upon this internal development aspect is then see, now one question that may come to your mind is, ma'am, if you are studying internal development for countries of South Asia, that means we have to study internal development when we are studying any other region as well. No, internal development is important for you only when it comes to South Asia. Suppose when we are studying Africa, if there is a political turmoil going on in Africa or there is some controversy going on with, say, the constitution making in Zimbabwe, we don't need to know about that. But when it comes to South Asia, the internal development becomes important for us. See, for example, Myanmar, when the military coup happened in Myanmar, what was one impact on India? It created a refugee situation for India in the northeastern states. That is why those internal developments are important for us, because they directly impact us of our neighboring countries. So this is one thing that is peculiar to South Asia that we will have to study. Then comes that when we are studying these bilateral relations, we have to see if there has been any important agreement, any important treaty. See, many a times when the Prime Minister visits any of these countries, say he visits Bangladesh or Bhutan, you will often read in the newspaper about memorandum of understanding being signed, MOUs being signed. You don't need to memorize the details of each and every minute MOU. Only if there is a very important agreement or treaty that has been signed during, say, a prime ministerial visit, that is what is important for us. In addition to this, with respect to every country of South Asia, unfortunately, we have some disputes or disagreements. There are some issues over which we do not see eye to eye with that country. So this also we need to be aware of. What are the disputes that we have with different countries of South Asia? Once we are done with this, suppose if there is any particular dispute or any particular development. Nowadays, when you see the UPSC questions of IR, they generally ask the questions in two parts. The first part will be very issue specific. The second part generally asks you, okay, what is going to be the bigger impact of this? So, what is the impact of this development for the whole region? Or if it is, say, an issue like terrorism, then it can have global impact also. So anything that you are studying, you need to also be aware that whether this thing has an impact for the whole region or whether it can have an impact at a global level, then that aspect also we have to look at when preparing South Asia. And now, these days particularly, we have an elephant in the room whenever we are studying South Asia, and that elephant in the room is China. So you cannot study about India's relationship with any part of the world without coming across a China angle. You will definitely come across a China angle. So, example, if you are studying India, Bangladesh, China is increasing its defense cooperation with Bangladesh a lot. So, how that impacts India? So, whenever we are, or when it comes to India, Bhutan, you all are aware of the Doklam issue. So, China is going to be ever present when we are studying international relations these days. China is going to come up whichever portion of India we are studying, whichever region we are studying. One aspect of China will come up. So, because of this, what I generally do is when we are studying our neighboring countries, I'll not cover China at that time. Once we have covered a chunk of India's relationship with other parts of the world, then with the major powers like USA, Russia, we take up China because by then you would have already covered how China impacts us with each and every region of the world. So, is it clear what kind of an approach we are going to take with respect to South Asia? If you have any question, you can just unmute yourself and ask. No questions? Can we move ahead? Okay. Now, another region that we will cover. So, I'm just giving you an indicative idea today of how we are going to approach the syllabus. And another thing this will help you with is that if you are studying any part of IR by yourself as well, if you want to refer to any book or any article, see if it is, you know, whether a book is relevant for you or not, whether an article is relevant for you or not. Once you know that these are the things that I have to look for, you can make that decision for yourself, okay, as to whether what I'm studying is relevant for me or not. When it comes to West Asia, Acha, which are the countries that we include in West Asia? Israel, yes. Yes, mostly what we are, when we say West Asia, we are basically referring to the Middle East. So you have your Israel, you have Saudi Arabia, UAE, Iran, all of these countries will become included in West Asia. One thing, when from a prelims perspective for South Asia or West Asia though is a UPSC favorite when it comes to prelims. The map of West Asia has to be imprinted in your mind. That is not something that I can make you memorize or I can do that for you. You have to do that by yourself. Please sit with the map. I don't know if you have already done that when you were studying geography. The sooner you start this practice, the better it is going to be for you. Sit with your atlas, and one of you has to mute yourself. Ashrita, I think it's you. You should really memorize the map, and particularly those of you, if you feel that you are weak in maps, you cannot visualize that easily the map of West Asia. What you must do is take your atlas, look at your atlas as if it is a Lakshmikant or a spectrum that you are studying, and literally take sticky notes and make notes in it. Like if I were to ask you which countries are bordering Israel, you should be able to tell me. If I ask you which countries are bordering Red Sea, you should be able to tell me. Which countries are bordering Syria, you should be able to tell me. So if you cannot visualize it so much, just write it down in sticky notes, look at it every day, learn it every day. That's how you're going to that's how the map is going to be easy for you. And questions from map are asked, particularly West Asia is very important from the mapping perspective, and questions in prelims are asked from it. And this is an exercise that you have to do by yourself. So when we are studying international relations, if you have not already done it, please spend half an hour every day in this exercise. Like if we are starting with South Asia, see the bordering countries, see which states of India are bordering that particular country. Try to frame questions in your own mind ki achha, if a question is asked to arrange the capitals from east to west, west to east, north to south, look at these things and make notes in the atlas from here. Okay, so this is going to be something that is going to be very important from your prelims perspective. Now coming to what I was discussing, when it comes to South Asia, West Asia, what is India's most important national interest when it comes to West Asia? Most important national interest. With each and every region, we have some or the other national interest. Fuel, energy. Yes, very good. So what we say is energy security. Energy security becomes our most important national interest when it comes to West Asia. Now, when we are studying West Asia, we will not cover it, will not cover the bilateral relations of India with each and every country of West Asia. That is not needed. Selectively, and this is, I hope you are making some notes of this, because sometimes you will see editorials or news or in your current affairs magazine about bilateral relations of, say, India Oman. That is not important for you. Bilateral relations of India Oman are not important for you. So which countries do you have to study in terms of bilateral relations in West Asia? One is going to be definitely Israel. One is going to be Iran, Saudi Arabia. And if you are very keen, you can also cover UAE. This is more than enough. This much of bilateral relations of West Asia. Otherwise, you don't have to cover for any other country of West Asia, these four. In addition to this, one is definitely energy security is a very important issue when it comes to India and West Asia. A second very important thing when it comes to our relations with West Asia, that is diaspora. That is, there's a lot of Indian origin people or Indian citizens who are actually going and working in these West Asian countries. So diaspora becomes very important. And see, diaspora is included in your syllabus. Questions have already been asked about Indian diaspora in some or the other region of the world. So when it comes to West Asia, particularly with the coming of the Modi government, there has been a lot of focus on the diaspora in the Middle East. So we need to understand what is this diaspora policy, that how we approach diaspora depends on which region of the world you're looking at. See, Indian diaspora in West Asia is very different from the Indian diaspora in, say, USA, or in the European countries. The Indian diaspora in US or Europe is already doing quite well financially. They are, you have Indian origin ministers, Indian origin people as head of these corporate organizations, or they are working as professors in the universities. But when it comes to West Asia, there the nature of the diaspora is a little different. There we mostly have the diaspora working as, a lot of them working as blue collar workers. So their interests are very different. So that is why we need to look at the diaspora aspect. And this diaspora has also been impacted because of COVID. So this becomes a new angle for us. I would say that in an exam situation can be a difficult question to answer, actually. If you're asked a question on how COVID-19 has impacted Indian diaspora in the Middle East or in West Asia. So this is also another aspect, that first we have to look at diaspora policy in West Asia and how the COVID-19 has impacted diaspora in West Asia. Also, West Asia is emerging as the new battleground between India and China. So as I said, China is going to be ever present in the different regions that we are going to study. So this is also something that we need to keep in mind when we are studying West Asia. And another very important aspect in West Asia is, so first we look at the bilateral relations, what are India's national interests, diaspora policy. You need to be aware of the Arab-Israeli conflict in West Asia. So one of you, particularly when I asked, which are the countries that are coming when we are studying West Asia, you mentioned Palestine. Now, our response or our policy with respect to Israel and with respect to Palestine, how it has evolved, that we need to understand. Particularly, to just give you an example, it was not until the 1990s that India opened its first embassy in Israel. But since the 1990s, particularly since our economic liberalization and definitely post 2014, India's relationship with Israel has become very strong. Whereas our support for the Palestinian cause has now, we do not so vehemently support the cause of Palestine as we used to do earlier. So there has been some evolution as to, how we approach this Israel-Palestine conflict. So I'll talk about this when we are covering West Asia. But these are broadly the things that we have to keep in mind when we are studying West Asia. So again, one of the purpose for me to tell this to you is that this will also help you when you are trying to filter things from the newspaper as to what is important for me or what is not important for me. This is how you should see that if any article is talking about energy security or what are India or China's conflicts in West Asia, then it is important for you. But if it is, say, talking about India-Turkey relations or India-Oman relations, India-Yemen relations, then that is not important for you. So this is about West Asia. Now, one region that is becoming very important these days for us in UPSC is asking questions in the mains regularly from here, that is our Indo-Pacific. Can you tell me which seas particularly fall in this construct of Indo-Pacific? Geographically, which are the important seas that fall in this Indo-Pacific region? Okay, Arabian Sea. Yes, very important. South China Sea. Yes, Sea of Japan. Yes, so when you're saying the Indian Ocean, one thing to remember is that when we say this Indo-Pacific, so it also, because we are referring to the Indian Ocean as well, we also have to include the eastern coast of Africa in this within this Indo-Pacific, because that's also where you have the Indian Ocean. So that is why when we study Africa nowadays, Africa is also becoming very important for the Indo-Pacific domain. So one thing that you keep hearing repeatedly when it comes to Indo-Pacific, if you have read about the recent AUKUS agreement, Quad, is whenever any prime minister like PM Modi or Biden give a statement, they say we are working towards a free and open Indo-Pacific, which is basically also a way of taking a stab at China, because China is like the adversary that we are trying to counter in the Indo-Pacific all through these things like Quad or AUKUS. Although it's not explicitly stated, but the main aim is of countering China. The reason being that it is feared, particularly in the South China Sea, China has a lot of conflicts with countries like Vietnam, Philippines. So to prevent China from, closing access to this Indo-Pacific for other countries, that's why there's this keep on emphasizing upon free and open Indo-Pacific. Another thing you will hear a lot is rules-based order. Rules-based order is nothing but, we will respect the international laws in the Indo-Pacific. So international laws like your UNCLOS, United Nations Convention of the Law of Seas. So these things are there in the Indo-Pacific. Now, when we are studying Indo-Pacific, we can divide it into some parts like East Asia. In East Asia, we have to cover China and Japan. When studying Indo-Pacific, we have Southeast Asia. Southeast Asia will be your ASEAN countries. Again, see, when it comes to the ASEAN countries, we don't have to cover it in terms of bilateral relation. Like you don't have to go and study India, Indonesia, India, Singapore. All of these individually, you don't have to study. At the max, we can look at India, Vietnam individually. But overall, when we are studying South Asia, our policies only, like nowadays you have Act East, earlier you had Look East. They talk about an engagement with the region as a whole, and particularly engagement with ASEAN than with the individual countries. So this is going to, here we are not going to take a bilateral approach when we are studying Southeast Asia. Particularly, we have to read about ASEAN. And again, when we are studying ASEAN, if you will see, whenever any conference of Quad happens or whenever any meeting of Quad happens, the leaders always emphasize that, okay, we have to also keep the interests of the ASEAN countries in mind. Again, if you will see the map, the ASEAN countries are important because of the maritime borders. So this will be your Southeast Asia. In addition to this, in the Southwest Pacific, Australia is important for us. New Zealand is not so important, but we have to be aware of particularly of India-Australia relations. Now, in the South, in the Indo-Pacific, there are obviously some issues that we have to see. The most important issue being that of China and the South China Sea conflict. So this will be one very important issue that we have to look at when it comes to Indo-Pacific. Also, when I tell you about the overall evolution of Indo-Pacific, India has historically been a country that has been more concerned with its land border, because we have had so many problems in our land borders, be it with Pakistan or be it with China. This, with Indo-Pacific, where the focus is shifting from land to the maritime domain, is relatively new in Indian foreign policy. If you do an analysis of, say, 5 years of UPSC question papers, you will obviously see that there was no question on Indo-Pacific or anything related to India's maritime foreign policy in 2012 or 2013. This is a very emerging area of Indian foreign policy. So you will see questions on this coming particularly from 2019 onwards. And of course, the UPSC can continue to ask questions on Indo-Pacific for a few years, because there are many aspects that it has not asked yet. So again, nowadays, Indo-Pacific is going to be very important for us. Then comes Africa. Now, again, in Africa, we will take a multilateral approach. Because see, Africa has close to 56 countries. We cannot study India's bilateral relations with Gambia, Nigeria, Namibia, each and every country. It's not possible. So when we say multilateral approach, we will see what has been India's relation with, say, the African Union or the Southern African Development Cooperation, the SADC. So we'll see with respect to these organizations and in a chunk. And as I said, the countries of East Africa become important because they are bordering the Indian Ocean. Now in Africa also, India has some interest, like particularly ONGC Videsh is involved in some exploration, oil exploration activities in Africa. So for energy security, Africa is also becoming important. But our relationship with Africa has had some ups and downs, in the sense that if you will read some foreign policy experts, they say that although India has invested so much in Africa in terms of giving aid, development aid, but India has not got a lot in return from Africa. So that pros and cons of India's engagement with Africa, we'll have to see. Now, why am I saying that we take a multilateral approach when we are studying Africa also is, if ever you come across news of, say, the vice president visiting Africa or the prime minister visiting Africa, you will see that they always visit a group of countries. They'll never go on a visit to just, say, Nigeria or just, say, South Africa. They visit a group of countries at once. So if any of the dignitaries are going to Africa, they'll visit 3-4 countries together. The reason being that our interests are not so large with each and every country individually. But yes, as a group, with a group of countries, it is a larger interest. So this becomes important. One very important aspect here when it comes to your prelims is, please see some of the locations where ONGC Videsh has made investment or is present where it is helping with the extraction of oil. So these map locations will become important for your prelims. Again, when it comes to Africa, please, the mapping part you have to cover by yourself. Please try to see the map in the sense that, see, suppose start with East Africa. See the countries in East Africa. Horn of Africa is very important. See the countries that are landlocked. These things you have to keep in mind by yourself. Also, the three lines that you have, like the Tropic of Cancer, Equator, Tropic of Capricorn, see the countries that lie above it or below it, or the through which these lines are directly passing. These things are going to be important from your prelims perspective. One last aspect that we have is our international organizations. Now, within international organizations, particularly we have to look at UN. In UN, the Security Council becomes important for us. Then we have to look at WTO, World Bank, IMF. Now, what particularly do we have to see in these organizations? See, your syllabus particularly mentions structure and mandate. Why structure is very important? See, most of these international organizations have emerged after the Second World War. And it is the victors of Second World War who have played an important role in forming these organizations, and they are the ones who have been powerful in these organizations. So for a country like India and for a few other developing countries as well, they always question the structures of these international organizations because they feel that, like India was not so important in, say, 1947 as it is in 2021. But still we say that, we do not have a seat in the Security Council. So when it comes to international organization, India will always, be talking about how the structure of these international organization is not reflective of the realities of 21st century. So that is why we have to particularly study the structure of international organizations like United Nations or World Bank, because India has this thing in its policies that these organizations are not reflecting how important India has become in the 21st century. So that is why we are looking for a seat, permanent seat in the Security Council that comes up. Now, one international organization that was not so important a few years back but has become very important now because of COVID is our WHO. So we need to look a little bit at WHO as well. This much is enough when it comes to international organizations. Now, another part is our regional organizations. So, in regional organizations, if you see here, structure is not so important for you. You don't have to spend so much of time in mugging up. Who is the head of, like you have a council of ministers or a council of governors. These things you need to know for the international organizations, not for the regional organizations. Like you don't need to know the structure of, say, the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. You don't have to memorize that. So structure is not important for regional organization because this is not something that India is concerned about. But when it comes to regional organization, we have to see how it is serving India's interest. Like till a few years back, India was not a full-time member of the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. But it has become now. So what interest is it serving for India? The interest that it is serving for India is that it is going to be a gateway for India into Central Asia. Central Asia is gaining importance in our foreign policy. So when it comes to the regional organization, we have to see what is it in this regional organization that is important for India, particularly our national interest. The structure of the regional organization, I'm again repeating, is not important for us from our examination point of view. So you do not have to memorize that. So this was so far an overview of how you should go about, referring to any article or anything that you are looking at. What are the important things that you are going to take a look at and how we will approach it when we are going to start with our classes now. Is it clear so far? Does it clarify a few things for you, how we will study IR? Any questions or doubts that you have? Definitely. We will also cover EU, and I was just giving you a brief idea of what we will do. We will definitely cover EU, South America, USA, all the major powers. Okay. So we'll start briefly today with how we are going to start the evolution of Indian foreign policy and continue tomorrow. See, Veda, that's a good question. How will you know which regional organizations are important and which are not? Those regional organizations are going to be important for you, which A, have been in news for some or the other reason for the last, say, 1 to 1.5 years. That is one easy way to know which organization is important for you. Second, where India has a membership. India is a full-time member. India is not a full-time member in all regional organizations. For example, India is not a member of, say, the Arctic Council. Right. So Arctic Council is not important for you because India is not a member of it. If we have any regional organization of South Asia, definitely that becomes important for us. Other than that, whatever has been in news is important for us. Where India has a full-time membership is important for us. India has observer status in some international, some regional organizations. That is not so important unless something very specific has come up. So rule of thumb is going to be any regional organization in South Asia is important, definitely, because obviously India is going to be a member of it. ASEAN is important as a regional organization. Any other organization where India has become a full-time member, like I gave you the example of SCO, that was not important, say, 5 years back, but it is important now. Organizations where India is not a member, like the Arctic Council, is not important for us. So this can be one rule of thumb for you to know what is important and what is not important. Other than that, again, as I said, in the Current Affair magazine, sometimes you will see a lot of obscure organizations that you have never heard of, many regional organizations that you have never heard of. You can go through that because I know I cannot predict a question in prelims from there, but at least from mains perspective, questions are not going to be asked from a very difficult regional organization that you have never heard of. Question will be asked from the ones that have been in news for some or the other reason, and we will cover them. Okay. So before I start with a very generic question, and I have already dealt with this briefly when I had taken the orientation, was when we say foreign policy, what does foreign policy want to do? What is the objective of the foreign policy of, say, any country? Not just India, like foreign policy of any country. Why does it exist? What does it want to achieve? Yeah, again, just I'll take one question. That PM visits many countries, definitely, thankfully, because of COVID, some of that has, that aspect has reduced a little bit. But yeah, PM, whenever the PM is visiting each and every country, you do not need to know. As I said, every time you will see that the Prime Minister visits a country, there will be at least 10 different MOUs that they are going to go ahead and sign there. Some MOU will be even to establish, say, a sports university in some country. That MOU and that information about that visit is in itself not important for you. What you can see is, suppose if India is going to Saudi Arabia and there is some agreement that is particularly focused on ensuring India's energy security, then that is important. But if suppose there is an agreement that India is signing during the Prime Minister's visit to Saudi Arabia, which is about a cultural exchange between India and Saudi Arabia, that is not important for you. But if there is an agreement saying that, Saudi Arabia is probably giving one particular oil field to ONGC to explore, then that is important because that is helping us secure our national interest. So you keep this one thing in mind as to what is our interest in that particular country where the PM has visited. And if there is anything related to that interest, then it is important in the sense you can just use it as an example in your answer. Apart from that, you won't be able to do much with that information. So in that sense, it is important. And see, it also depends on why the Prime Minister is visiting a particular country. Sometimes it can just be because, for instance, the Prime Minister visited Bangladesh because it was 50 years of Bangladesh's independence. That is an important event. So we'll have to see. And if there is something very significant, we will cover that in our current affairs. So you don't worry about that. But yes, if you are reading about that in the newspaper, each and every agreement is not important for you. You see as to whether what interest it is serving for India. Only then you take it in your notes or you memorize it. Otherwise, it's not important. Okay. So yes, now rightly someone's pointed out that the objective of foreign policy is securing national interest. This is fine, securing national interest. Give me some example of what is the national interest of India at present. What are some examples of our national interest? Because national interest in itself seems to be a very vague term. Security, okay. Very good. Territorial integrity, that is, and this was particularly very important for India in the early years of its independence, was protecting our territorial integrity and our sovereignty. Okay, this sovereignty and territorial integrity you can also link with, say, if you have read a little bit about the non-alignment movement. Why did we want to be non-aligned during the period of the Cold War? The reason being that we were a newly independent country and we had just come out of the yoke of imperialism. We feared that if we are caught up in this rivalry between two superpowers, this sovereignty and this territorial integrity that we have just won, we are going to lose it. So this was one very important national interest for India at that time. National interest also evolves, okay? National interest, it will also change with time a little bit. So we were very concerned and very conscious of our sovereignty during the Cold War period. But now are we a non-aligned country? Well, we generally do not enter into military alliances. But still, now we cannot go ahead and call ourselves a non-aligned country, because now that India has remained an independent country, a strong country for so many years, we are not so concerned that, you know, someone is going to come and impact our sovereignty. So this one becomes very important, that one national interest, and this was particularly important for India in the early years of its independence, was protecting its sovereignty. Right? Territorial integrity, sovereignty, national security. National security, of course, continues to remain, I mean, for any country, it will continue to remain a very important objective. And one particular challenge to our national security that we have is, say, the threat of terrorism from Pakistan that impacts our national security. So you will see that whenever Indian Prime Minister or Indian dignitaries are speaking in international organizations like the UN, they will always bring up the issue of terrorism, because that is directly linked to our national security. So foreign policy, we have to always, always connect with what national interest is it related to. It is not happening in vacuum. Okay. Other than this, so we have sovereignty, we have national security. Anything else? See, you're very, Veda has written about Atmanirbhar Bharat. So I'll just expand that a little bit. See, our economic prosperity or our economic development is also linked to our foreign policy. So when you're saying Atmanirbhar Bharat, what is basically the objective of something like Atmanirbhar Bharat? It's basically India's economic development. And that is why you will see that whenever the Prime Minister visits countries like US or any European country, he will have a meeting with some of these top CEOs, okay, or the top businessmen. And what do they talk about? Bringing investment to India. They talk about FDI, right? So economic prosperity or economic development is also connected with our foreign policy. When you're talking about Atmanirbhar Bharat, and this can also be linked a little bit to defense as well, you see that within defense these days, we are talking a lot about Make in India. Make in India in the defense sector. In fact, General Bipin Rawat was someone who really took this up of Make in India, or making India self-sufficient when it comes to defense manufacture. So, as I said, how you should study when the Prime Minister is visiting a country. Suppose if the Prime Minister is visiting Israel. Israel is a country that has given a lot of emphasis on high-end technology defense. Okay, so if he's visiting Israel and he's signing some kind of an agreement on high-end technology transfer between India and Israel, that becomes important for us, because that is directly related to, one, this whole our defense, and also with the Make in India aspect. So this also becomes one national interest for us. In addition, these are the primary ones. In addition, you will read a lot about, have you heard of this phrase, soft power? If there is anyone with political science optional, you would have definitely come across this. Soft power is talks more of, for example, to help you understand, Bollywood is a form of soft power. The popularity of Bollywood for India is a form of soft power. So one interest that we try to also get with foreign policy is extending India's soft power. So one example of this is also the yoga, celebration of Yoga Divas. So all this is what? This is not directly securing anything for India. If people in America are observing Yoga Divas and sitting in a park and doing yoga, that is not achieving anything for India directly at that point, but it is more of an image building for India. Of course, it can have tangible benefits for India later on in the form of tourism. So every country, and China definitely is, earlier, of course, it was USA, and the fact that we are talking in English, the importance of Hollywood shows the impact of US soft power. But China is also nowadays giving a lot of emphasis on soft power. Once a question was asked on cricket diplomacy between India and Pakistan. So that is that all cricket diplomacy becomes a form of soft power. So another interest that is not very high on the list, but definitely that comes within foreign policy, is enhancing the country's soft power. Is it clear? Okay. So these are some ways in which we can understand as to what is the objective of foreign policy. Sovereignty, securing territorial integrity, national security, economic prosperity, defense of the country, and enhancing soft power. Okay. Now we'll talk a little bit about what are the factors that we take into account when it comes to foreign policy, or what factors impact foreign policy. Some of it is not even in our hands. So the one very important determinant of foreign policy is our geography. That is geographically where we are located. So India's particular position in South Asia, our location in South Asia, impacts our foreign policy a lot. You see, India, because of its geography, is faced, unfortunately, with a hostile neighborhood. We have in our neighborhood, we have Pakistan, we have China, countries that are not very well disposed towards India. So because of this, India's border security has an important place in its foreign policy. And why is it so? Because it has been made so by geography. And if I go a little bit back into history as well, then geography also impacts how we connect with the rest of the world. So India was not a very, if you have read about the Chola Empire in your ancient or medieval history, historically, overall, India had peaceful relations with the neighborhood, except since we did experience some of the invasions from Northwest, like we had the Ahmad Shah Abdali coming into India. But, and all of these other invasions from the Northwest we had into India, but it was not a very serious challenge that India experienced historically. And that has been also one of the reasons why the borders that India has with other countries, with its neighboring countries, has not been very fixed, or it has not been very determinable. So because of this, you will see, India has conflicts with China over the demarcation of the borders. Or if you see, when it comes to Bangladesh, you have the problem of infiltration of refugees from Bangladesh or from Myanmar. The reason being that the borders of India have remained very porous. They have not been very clearly defined. And even where the Britishers have tried to define these borders, like with respect to China, China says that, okay, these borders were defined by the British and we do not accept these borders. So this becomes a challenge that India confronts geographically because of the lack of fixed borders. So geography has definitely impacted our foreign policy. The political borders of South Asia has tended to be artificial in nature. Another problem is that, and this you have probably been reading particularly recently because of what happened in Afghanistan, that we do not have any direct route right now with Afghanistan. We are dependent on Pakistan, and Pakistan does not has not mostly allowed India to trade with Afghanistan directly. Or if we want to extend our reach to Central Asia, then what is happening? We are boxed by Pakistan. Because of the presence of Pakistan, we cannot have a land route going directly to Central Asia. We had to, you know, develop that route through Iran and the Chabahar port and all of that. So because geographically, we are boxed by, on one side, we have Pakistan, and on the other side, we have Bangladesh. So because of the presence of Bangladesh, we cannot directly, although with Bangladesh, we do not have such hostile relations as we have with Pakistan, but it impacts how India can access the Southeast Asian countries. So geography impacts how we conduct our foreign policy. So for example, say for a country like USA, which is not placed in such a hostile neighborhood. For them, their foreign policy can be more outward focused. But for us, a lot of our foreign policy, or one important aspect that, or somewhere where we have to spend a lot of resources in our foreign policy, is in the maintenance of our borders. Why? Because of all these reasons. The geography, the borders are not fixed, they have been artificial, and also that we are boxed in one side by Pakistan and the other side by Bangladesh. Of course, geography also has its advantages. It is not only disadvantages. One advantage that India has because of geography is we have a long coastline. And this has given us a very important position, or a prominent position, in the Indian Ocean. So no country, a country like USA, cannot think of having an Indo-Pacific partnership today without including India, because India is so integrally located in the Indian Ocean. So geography gives us certain advantages as well as it has given us certain disadvantages. So this is one of the determinants of foreign policy. Second that I have here is strategic culture, but I'll come back to this a little later. Another thing is our requirements and goals. We briefly discussed this as well, that based on what our particular interest is at that particular point, that also impacts our foreign policy. Like as we discussed, territorial integrity or sovereignty is important. In South Asia, we would definitely want a more peaceful external environment. So we work towards that, and constantly we take up the issue of terrorism in international forums. So this is one aspect. So whatever goals and requirement we seek to serve, that impacts our foreign policy. We discussed this already, like I told you, what are the objectives of the foreign policy. And according to that, we change our foreign policy. This is important. The global and regional challenges also impact our foreign policy. For example, during the Cold War, we forged a close relationship with the Soviet Union, although initially we were non-aligned, but particularly because of the war with China and later the war with Pakistan, we forged a close relationship with Soviet Union. And what Soviet Union helped us particularly was in the development of our defense sector. Even now, you know that a majority of India's defense equipments are of Soviet origin. So this was during the Cold War. But post-Cold War, particularly after we did our economic liberalization in 1990s, we also started having a good relationship with US because it was important for our economy. And also what happened in the 1990-91 was the disintegration of the Soviet Union. So once the disintegration of Soviet Union was not as powerful, and for a period we had the hegemony of US, so we had to develop a good relationship with US. Similarly, in addition to India-US, nowadays what has become another very important relationship for India and international affairs is our relationship with Japan. Our relationship with Japan has become very important. Again, this is a newer development in Indian foreign policy. You would not have seen this till a few years back. It was our relation with Japan were earlier very low-key or insubstantial. But now India-Japan relations are so important that we are not just working together with each other, but we are also working with each other in third countries. So for example, you have India and Japan partnering together in Sri Lanka for the development of the port. So India, Japan today are also working in third countries. So this is a newer development in Indian foreign policy. So today our relationship with Russia is not as important as it was during the time of the Cold War. So this has evolved. Again, as our priorities change, how we engage with regional organizations or with other smaller organizations also change. For example, in the initial period of our foreign policy, NAM was very important. Commonwealth was very important. What you call as G77 was basically an alliance of developing countries. That was very important. But you barely, you know, now when you're preparing for international relations, you will barely see, you know, the Prime Minister has skipped so many meetings of NAM. These are not so relevant. Now, what are we talking about? We are talking about organizations like SCO. We are talking about, say, ASEAN. These regional organizations have become more important. So, as times have evolved, which regional organizations or which groupings or coalition are important for us, that also continues to change and evolve. For that matter, when it comes to EU, one of you, I think someone was asking that question. India-EU relationship today is not as important as some of these other organizations like SCO or ASEAN. So things evolve. Our foreign policy will continue to evolve in this way. Which country is important for us? With which country our national interests are better served? These are going to change with time. That is what we have to keep in mind when we are studying the evolution of foreign policy. Now, one part that I did not explain to you was about that strategic culture. What do you think is meant by this strategic culture? What is strategic culture? Ideology like political, okay. Yes, to a certain extent, it can depend on the ideology that is prevailing at that time. Yes, very good. Along with the ideology, what is most important is the execution plus the planning of it. Mainly, we discussed that we have some national interest, but how will you fulfill that national interest? To fulfill that national interest, you will need some kind of strategy in place. See, we decided that okay, energy security is one of our national interest with middle with West Asia. But how are we going to fulfill that national interest of energy security? We will go ahead and partner, cause a partner, bring about a partnership between, say, the Aramco and the ONGC Videsh. That can be one strategy. That can be a strategy involving the PSUs of the two countries. So this is how, whatever path that you are taking to fulfill this national interest, as you say, whatever plan that you are making, that becomes your strategy. Like right now, your goal is to clear the UPSC exam. That's your interest. That's the goal that you have made. But what is the strategy that you have made for it? Whenever you see, watch any toppers' interviews, what questions do they ask? What was your strategy for preparing history? What was your strategy for prelims? So that's the path that they took. That's the breaking down of the steps, right? That is your strategy. Now, this strategic culture also has evolved for India with time. Again, when we see the Nehruvian era, that time, as we discussed, what was our national interest? Safeguarding our sovereignty, our territorial integrity, because we were a newly independent nation at that time. And for that, the strategy that we took was that of non-alignment. We decided that we are not going to side with either of the superpower. And again, when I will explain to you more about non-alignment did not mean neutrality. It did not mean neutrality, okay? So we took the strategy of non-alignment at that time, because one of the reason that we really wanted that, we did not want somewhere else to come and interfere in our domestic or international affairs. So we wanted to protect our autonomy. So this was the reason why we were taking the path of non-alignment. In addition to that, we also linked non-alignment with developing a solidarity or with partnering with other countries of Asia, Africa, who had recently become independent. Because we thought that, you know, when we it's like when we come together, the strength is there. So only India going the path of non-alignment was not enough. India needed other countries along with it in that journey of non-alignment so that it can have some impact in international affairs. So definitely, when we are talking about our strategic culture at that time, we had non-alignment. And along with that, we were partnering and developing solidarity with other developing nations that had recently become independent. So this was our strategic culture in the initial years of our independence. However, when the Soviet Union collapsed, that is, from the 1990s onwards, there is some change in our strategic culture, in the sense that some scholars have called the non-alignment as a strategic culture to be very utopic or idealistic. We will see that it was not completely idealistic. It was actually, to a certain extent, pragmatic for India at that point of time to be non-aligned. But after the collapse of the Soviet Union in the 1990s, and you must have studied in your economy about the economic crisis of 1991 that India faced, because of which we had the LPG reforms. All of this meant that now our foreign policy made a shift from this non-alignment idealistic posture to becoming. Keshav, you need to mute yourself. to becoming pragmatic and realistic. This happened in the 1990s. Why? Because at this point, we could not remain aloof from a country like the US or a country like Israel for that matter, which were doing economically very well. And we needed to develop our economy at that stage. So in our strategic culture, economic security becomes very important along with the sovereignty. We cannot only, you know, now it has been some years since our independence. So we cannot say that, okay, now, even till now that we will be non-aligned because we want to protect our sovereignty or we don't want another country to interfere in our domestic affairs. That objective has to a large extent been achieved. Now our strategic culture has to give importance to economic prosperity. So this is what happens in the 1990s. The third evolution, and this evolution is what you are seeing now, in this is in the 21st century, the evolution in our strategic culture is that, and I think there was an essay in UPSC on this, that India is no longer a balancing power, but a leading power. Today, we do not want to, you know, just say, help the US balance China in Asia by using India. That is not just what we want. In fact, you will see that India, despite being a part of Quad, will often want to, you know, exercise that, okay, when it comes to the Indo-Pacific, it is not blindly following the US. Why? Because today in our strategic culture, we want to have our position amongst the great powers because, well, our economy has done very well. We have a large demography. So because of these factors, we want that today we should be recognized as one of the great powers. And to become one of the great powers, we are also taking on more international responsibility. What do I mean by this? See, if you have read about the Paris Agreement in your environment, India has come up with very ambitious INDC, or India has a very ambitious goals in its INDC that it has laid out. So we are taking a very leading role, particularly when it comes to, say, the climate change or when it comes to renewable energy. Give me one example of India's leading role in the field of renewable energy. Solar Alliance. Yes, very good. The International Solar Alliance. That is the best example of India's leadership. Today, we are not just, you know, if one country is making an initiative, we are not just going and joining that. We are taking responsibility. We are starting an organizing alliance like the International Solar Alliance, where it was India's initiative. So this becomes important that today we are aspiring to be a great power that is taking international responsibility. Another example of this during COVID, although this came under a bit of criticism later on, was our vaccine diplomacy, right? At least before the second wave hit India, India was providing vaccine to so many countries, to Africa, to its South Asian neighbors. So this also shows our great power ambitions, because you cannot become a great power without taking some amount of responsibility. And of course, the biggest recognition that at least India wants for its great power status is a permanent seat in the UN Security Council, which probably may not happen in the years to come, but this is an ambition that we are working towards. So this is how our strategic culture has evolved. And three areas where India's stature is rising in being recognized as a great power, or India playing an important role. One, this is also important. One is the issue of terrorism. Here also, you can see India taking a leading position. India be it in any international forum, India always takes up the issue of terrorism because obviously it is very integrally connected with our national security. Climate change, we already talked about, and the rise of China. Today, if any country wants to tackle China, or then a partnership with India becomes very important. So these are also some of the factors that is helping India in its culture of trying to achieve great power. So I'm going to stop here, and we will look at the phases of Indian foreign policy from tomorrow onwards. Are the things that we discussed today clear to you? This was mostly just a kind of introduction. We will properly begin with the evolution of foreign policy from tomorrow. But is it clear, all the things that we have discussed today? Okay. So we'll stop here for today, and do you guys make notes in the class? I hope you sit with a pen and paper and make notes. Okay, very good. So you can go ahead now and go and have your breakfast. We started very early, and I will see you all again tomorrow. 7:30 a.m. will be our time, okay? Okay, everyone, bye. Thank you, guys. Thank you, Lokesh. Bye.